Hello and welcome to the 11th lecture in the course Optimization and Data Science. The topic of this lecture is convergence measures for iterative algorithms. I will start with a motivation on the convergence speed and then a short recall to the topic that we had in the last lecture, where we already studied the convergence of the gradient method with the exact step size for quadratic functions. And then we get two main concepts of measuring or quantifying the convergence speed. The first one is the Q factor, Q coming from quotient. This is the one we already defined or used in the last lecture for this quadratic function. And later on the R factor, which comes from the term root. In between, we have to discuss a little bit, I want to mention a little bit the accumulation points in contrast to limit points, because in the formal mathematical definitions of Q factor and R factor, the term accumulation points plays a role. And at the end, I will define the concepts of linear and superlinear convergence. These two concepts are defined using the Q and the R factor. So starting from with the motivation, we have defined general descent methods and the gradient methods, and all these methods generate sequences of iterates. And we want to make sure, of course, that these sequences converge to a minimizer, but we also want to measure the convergence speed. And the speed of different sequences converging to the same point can be quite different, and also the convergence speed of iterative algorithms, iterative optimization algorithms, can be very different. And the convergence speed is a main criterion on the quality of an optimization algorithm. It indicates how many iteration steps we need to achieve a desired accuracy. Of course, the second criterion for an optimization algorithm is the necessary effort that we have per iteration step. And both criteria together, they give the quality of the method. And for the motivation here in this lecture, we will use very simple sequences to understand the concept of convergence measures. And we will consider the following sequences. And you can see them here all where I indicated or wrote down the first elements of the sequence and then the general formulation of the sequence, which of course in an iterative algorithm is not always possible that I have an explicit formula for the kth iterate. But this will help to compute the convergence speed of this method. And you can see here I just half on every element of the sequence, I get 1 over 2 to the power of k for the element, and clearly this sequence converges to 0. If I take the second one, it also converges to 0, but it's just 1 over k, so 1, 1 over 2, 1 over 3. The next one is 1 over factorial of k. And the last one is very interesting to understand the differences between the Q factor and the R factor, because it's some kind of alternating sequence. It can be written like this. We have here parameter inside, parameter s between 0 and 1, and we have here s to the power of k, and then we have here something which is 1 plus 1 half or minus 1 half. So we have here an alternating part. And you can see that we get something like this, 3 over 2, 1 over 2, and then s is getting, the power of s is always getting higher. And it's also clear that if s is lower than 1 and greater than 0, that this sequence also converges to 0, but they have a quite different speed. And we will use these examples to measure the different speed. In the last lecture, we had the convergence of the gradient method for a quadratic function. So in the general quadratic function, which looks like this, we can compute an exact step size in the descent algorithm, which looked like this. We all did this in the last lecture, And we started some diagonal matrix, which is very simple, and B and C were just zero. And there we can compute, or we could compute, we have here a factor A or parameter A in the matrix, we could compute this behavior. The difference between the kth iterate and the limit, and the difference of the kth plus first iterate and the limit was this factor. So we decrease the difference or the distance to the limit point, which was zero in this case. It's always changing with this factor. And since A was bigger than zero, this factor is less than one. So the distance in every iteration gets smaller and smaller. So we will have some kind of convergence. And since this red term here is a quotient between this term and this one, we call this the Q factor. This was a simple motivation. And we also see that if A is equal 1, then we have here 0. So we have direct convergence in one step, or very fast convergence if the Q factor is 0. And if A is much bigger than 1, then this factor, this red factor here, the Q factor, is approximately 1. It's very close to 1, so the convergence will be slow. The reduction in the difference to the limit point will decrease very slowly if this factor is close to 1. Okay. Now coming to the first definition, which we already had very shortly, here it's in a more, or maybe it's again the same thing. So the first way to describe or measure the convergence is to study these two terms here. So if we have a sequence xk and we have a limit x star, which is in our examples known, then we can compare the difference of the kth iterate to the next to the limit point, and of the next iterate to the limit point. And we can write it like this. There we have the quotient, and we get a sequence here. If we have a lower bound qk here of this quotient, then we get a sequence of this qk. In our example with the quadratic function, this was a constant sequence because this was always the same, but it hasn't been the case. And this, of course, only works here, the definition with a division here by this term, if xk is not equal to the limit point. Otherwise, we had a zero here. And now we can use this sequence qk to characterize the convergence speed. And if this sequence qk that we generate here is constant, or it converges to some q, we call this q the q factor, quotient factor of the sequence. This is exactly what we did in the last lecture with the quadratic function, where we could easily compute the qk, and it was constant. It was this fraction of a minus 1 and a plus 1. And now, considering our four example sequences in the beginning, we have this sequence here, where we have 1 over 2 to the power of k. It converges to 0, x star is 0. And now my exercise for you here is stop the tape, take a sheet of paper, and compute the values qk. So perform exactly this computation here. Take two elements of the sequence, minus x star is then 0, so you have to compute the quotient of two successive iterates or elements of the function, and you have to find a number which is an upper bound of this sequence, then sequence of quotients that you then get. This would be the qk. So this is not that difficult to compute here, xk plus 1 divided by xk, because x star is always 0. But you can stop the tape now and compute the values qk. This is the answer. This is the solution. I compute this here, and x star is 0. So I have to compute 1 over 2 to k plus 1 divided by 1 over 2 to the power of k. And obviously this is 1 over 2, and this, so that here we can have exactly equal, so not lower equal, just it's equal qk 1 over 2, and this constant, because the relation of these two terms is always 1 over 2, and this is the q factor then. This is 1 half. Second example, we have this sequence here, where we just have 1 over k. Of course, this also tends to 0, and we can perform the same computation. And again, stop the tape, take your sheet of paper, and write it down. And this is also not difficult to just insert this. It's k over k plus 1, and this is now our qk. This is now not a constant sequence. The qk is not constant. So we have to compute the limit of this sequence. Yeah, what is the limit of this sequence? The limit of this sequence is 1 if k goes to infinity. Thus, here the q factor is 1, taking the second part of our definition that we had here. Q factor, or this sequence, is either constant or it converges to some limit. Third example, k factorial, 1 over k factorial. Obviously, this sequence also tends to 0. And again, compute the values qk and the limit of the sequence, because here again, it's not a constant sequence. Stop the tape and take your sheet of paper and perform this small exercise. Yeah, by the definition of the factorial, it's clear that we can, most terms cancel out, and we remain with 1 over k plus 1, which is our qk. And what is the limit of this sequence? The limit of the sequence is 0, so the q factor is 0. So we had three different examples. We had here 0. In this example, we had 1. And in the first example, we had 1 over 2. If you look at the number of this, you can directly see that the q factor is a measure of the convergence speed, because the convergence speed of this sequence is very slow. The convergence speed of this one is very high, where the q factor is 0, and the first one was in between, where the q factor was 1 over 2. Okay, in iterations, or coming iterations coming from optimization algorithms, we usually have, or we not always have, a uniform convergence. We might have something that is similar to this example, and here we also have a parameter s. So this is a little bit more tricky to compute it, to compute the q factor. But again, since we have this alternating behavior, we need now to look at odd and even terms for k, or at odd or even values of k, and perform the q factors separately. So we need two computations, one for k even, one for k odd. And there they are. So this is not that easy. So if you want to, you can compute this also on the paper, that for k even, k plus 1 is odd. And we get this term here. We get 1 over 2, because we then have the minus 1, so 1 minus 1 half. And in the denominator, we have an even k. Here, the k is even. We have 3 over 2. So there we always get s divided by 3. For odd k, it's the other way around. We get 3s. And this is our alternating sequence now, qk. It's not constant, and it does not have a limit point, because s is fixed. And this sequence is alternating. The sequence QK, it has two constants. It's always alternating between these two constants, S divided by 3 and 3S. So our definition up to now is not applicable. We have two subsequences, each of which converges to what's called an accumulation point. The bigger one determines the convergence speed of our sequence. So we have to extend our definition of the Q factor a little bit. And this is done by accumulation points. So in the last example, it's very clear what accumulation points are, because we have a sequence which one half of the sequence is constant to this value, the other half is constant to this one, and these two values are accumulation points. But it can also be that these two subsequences are not constant, but they are both convergent to different values. And this is the concept of accumulation points. Yeah, so we continue with the accumulation points. And here's the definition. So the mathematical definition for a sequence xk, and we are mainly interested in the biggest accumulation point, which is also called the limit superior of a sequence, denoted by lim sub of the sequence for k to infinity. And it's defined as the limit of the lowest upper bound of all sequence elements where the indices are bigger or equal than index k. So let's have a look at the definition of the lowest upper bound of a sequence. So this is the definition. So superior means the lowest upper bound of a sequence. And this term describes this very exactly. In the mathematical formulation, we can write it like this. We are looking here only at elements of the sequence with indices higher or equal to a given fixed index k. So we're looking at the part, at the last part, you can say, of the sequence. Still, it's an infinite sequence because we just omit the first k minus 1 elements of the sequence. So we look at this part of the sequence with higher indices than k, or higher or equal than k, and we're looking for the lowest upper bound. And this can be written like this. We're looking for a real number which is greater or equal all this sequence elements for l greater than k. And for all these numbers m we can find, which are upper bounds, we look for the lowest one. Okay, we will see this in more detail for the examples that we have. And we perform this computation for every k, where k is fixed. So we get a lowest upper bound for every k, and then we take the limit of this lowest upper bounds. So this is not very easy. But with our sequences here that we have in the example, it's not that difficult, and this helps to understand the concept. But we need this in the general concept for general sequences to define convergence measures. So if a sequence, so talking about the original sequence xk, is a convergent sequence, the limit superior equals the limit. It differs for non-convergent sequences, and it's only important, yeah, for sequences with two or more converging subsequences. We are looking only for the biggest accumulation point, or the limit superior. The limit inferior, the smallest accumulation point, is not important for our considerations here. So let's look at the simplest example. So we have a sequence minus 1 to the power of k. It's not convergent. It has two accumulation points. For odd k, the sequence is constant minus 1. For even k, the sequence is constant with values 1. So we have two subsequences which are constant, and thus they too converge also to minus 1 and 1 respectively. So now we can look at this lowest upper bounds. If we fix k, we first fix a k and look for the sequence elements with indices bigger or equal to k. And now we try to find an upper bound. An upper bound, since these two subsequences are constant, an upper bound for all elements is 1. Because y minus 1 is less or equal than 1. So an upper bound for all sequence elements with indices greater or equal to k is 1. And also the minimum of these upper bounds is 1. I cannot find a smaller value m here such that all sequence elements are lower or equal than this m. So the minimum here is 1 for every k, because the sequences, the two subsequences are constant. So we get here a 1 for all k. We consider it for a fixed k first, but then we see it's always the same, it's always 1. 1 is an upper bound for all the elements. So we get here 1, and thus the biggest accumulation point is also 1, because applying the limit now to this lowest upper bound, which are constant, gives the value 1. Okay, and it's obvious from looking at the sequence that the biggest accumulation point is 1. This is the smallest accumulation point. The second example is a little bit more difficult, because we have here an additional term 1 over k. It's also not convergent. It has also two subsequences. One is, since this term is converging to 0, we have now a subsequence converging to minus 1 and the other one converging to 1. But to write it down formally, we look again at the lowest upper bound of the whole sequences, but only starting from a given index k. So we fix 1k. And if I fix 1k, I see a bound for the sequence is taking here a 1 and then a 1 over k. For all other higher indices, this term gets smaller. So 1 plus 1 over k is an upper bound, and it's also the lowest upper bound, because if k is even, then it's exactly this value. And if it's k is odd, I get negative values for the sequence elements, because I have here minus 1 plus 1 over k, and then again this 1 is a positive number, is also an upper bound for the odd indices, for the elements with odd indices. So, and this is true for all k. For every k, I have 1 plus 1 over k as lowest upper bound of the sequence. Now I'm taking the limit of this term, and it's easy, the limit is 1. The biggest accumulation point is again 1. And yeah, from the sequence, looking at the sequence, it's obvious, but this is a mathematical computation that gives this value. So the general definition of the Q factor is taking the biggest accumulation point of this quotient if the limit does not exist. If the limit exists, again, that's the same what we did in the first examples. This was possible, but if we have here some alternating sequence of the QK, then we need the notion of the accumulation point. So what we do is, for each k, we find the smallest number k that satisfies this inequality. Then the q factor is the biggest accumulation point of this sequence qk. If the qk is a constant sequence, that's easy. If there is a limit of the sequence, also easy. And only if we have some alternating sequence here, then we need the biggest accumulation point. And the Q factor describes an upper bound for the convergence speed, because we take the limit superior, or in the definition of the limit superior, we always look at an upper bound. Okay, and now this can be used in this fourth example of my sequences in the beginning. we had this sequence here, this was the general definition, and we have here some alternating behavior, 3 over 2, 1 over 2. The sequence still converges to 0 because I have this term s to the power of k. And we already computed this qk, that qk is an alternating sequences, a sequence. What is the biggest accumulation point? Yeah, s is between 0 and 1, and obviously 3s is bigger than s divided by 3. So this is the q factor. So the limit superior of the sequence is 3s. The q factor is one way to determine a convergence speed. It looks at the improvement in every step, and then taking into account the limit, the maximum of this improvement, or the worst case is the maximum of these two numbers here in this example, but this is the worst case. In fact, in every second iteration for this example, we have a better convergence, because here this quotient is smaller, this number. So the q factor always overestimates this quotient here, and that's what was written here. It described an upper bound from the convergence speed. And this is the reason why there is another concept, which is the R factor. And it's something like an average convergence speed. So if the QK has different accumulation points, the sequence of the quotients, we may measure the average convergence speed. So we had something like this, and we can compute for the first k steps, we will get that xk now, the difference from of xk to the limit point of the sequence is now multiplication of all these qk's here. And then we get here the difference from the initial value. And if we now compute the geometric mean of this, all these factors we get here, we get a value I call rk, which is the kth root of this k factors here that we sum up, or that we accumulate, we multiply, of course, that are accumulate in k steps of the iteration. And then we can also write that the kth root of this quotient is less or equal rk by this definition. This is just taking here again the division by this term, and then computing here the kth root of this term. Then we get here the rk. And this rk is the R factor, with the same definition that we use, again, the limit superior here. This is the root factor of the sequence. It's somehow, this is an average convergence speed. If the Q factor, or the sequence of quotients here that we computed for the Q factor, is constant, then both factors are the same. If the Q K here converges to some Q, then they are also the same. In general, the R factor is less or equal than the Q factor, and this we can see in these examples. So example one, the QK was constant, the R factor should be like the Q factor from my last slide. Again, this was the sequence, and we computed the QK 1 over 2, and the Q factor was this 1 over 2 because it was the limit of this, is just constant. So now we compute this term here. We compute xk minus x star. X star is 0, so this is just 1 over 2 to the power of k. X 0 to x minus x star is 1, so this is just the kth root of this term, which is 1 over 2. So the root factor, by our definition, is also 1 over 2. It's the same. This was the case where the qk is constant. Second example, we had this sequence, 1 over k. We computed the qk's here, which tend to 1. The q factor is 1, And the QK, they converged here. Here was a real convergence. The alpha R factor should be the same, and we can compute it directly. We compute, again, this term, which is 1 over K divided by 1. And this here, this sequence can be written like this, and it converges to 1, which can be seen if we perform a little computation here with a logarithm. We write this k's root as an exponent, take the logarithm out of it, then we have 1 over k log k, and this terms tends to 0 because the logarithm is tends to infinity with a lower speed than every polynomial, and of course also slower than the linear function. This is something which is proved in mathematics. This tends to 0. So here we would need a little bit analysis to compute this. So the limit of this is 1, performing here from the, so here we have the limit of the logarithm is 0, and then taking again the exponential logarithm, a continuous function, we can exchange here logarithm and exponential and the limit process, so we can take here e power this limit, e to the power of 0 gives 1, so the limit of this sequence is 1. This is computation from analysis, which is not very difficult, which gives again the same result for Q and R factors, because the sequence QK is convergent. Again, for the third example, we had here the Q factor was 0, because this sequence here tends to 0. And we can also compute directly the R factor. Inserting this here, once again, we get the kth square root of k factorial here, which still tends to infinity. And this is again something which is usually shown in analysis. So again, here we have the R factor 0. The interesting case is the case where the R factor is different from the Q factor. And this is the case for this fourth example, with the alternating sequence. Again, this was like this, and we computed the sequence QK, which was for even K like this, for odd K like this. Q factor was the biggest accumulation point, which is 3s. Now compute the R factor. And if you want to have another exercise, stop the tape, take a sheet of paper and compute it with the root, the kth root. And here it is. So again, we have to split for even k and odd k. For even k, so the initial value is always 3 over 2, so the first element of the sequence. But then we get here 3 over 2 s to the power of k, or 1 over 2 s to the power of k. We're taking the kth root. Then we get here s, of course, in the numerator here, and then just 1, because 3 over 2 cancels out. So here we get just s. And here is something that remains, is the kth root of 1 over 3, which tends to 1. So taking here, we have a constant value for the even ones, and for the odd ones, we get in the limit, we get here also s. So the biggest accumulation point of these two subsequences is s. In fact, this sequence converges to s. Here it's constant, and for odd k it converges to s. So the whole sequence converges to s. The R factor is s. And there is now a difference. So that's what we have seen for our two factors, for the Q and the R factors, and for our four examples. We had the three examples where both are the same, and for the alternating example they were different. Difference only if the convergence of the sequence, of the original sequence, is not uniform, as in the last example, and this often occurs in sequences of iterates in optimization algorithms. And the Q and R factors, they are used to define linear and superlinear and also sublinear convergent. So we call a sequence convergent if the we call them a convergent sequence linear convergent if the factors are less than one. We call it superlinear convergence if this limits the two factors computed by the limits are zero, and we call them sublinear convergence for the Q factor if the Q factor is greater equal one, for the R factor if it's equal to one. If the R factor is bigger than one, then the sequence will not converge. Okay, and this is the table for our examples. But now this is, we can see now here, depending in the last example, depending on S, we get that for different values of S, we get a linear or sublinear convergence. And we considered here only values S lower than one. Okay. One important quality criterion for iterative algorithm is the convergence speed, and we measure this with the Q and the R factors. The Q factor describes the maximum of the reduction in the distance between iterate and the limit point. And the R factor describes the geometric average of this reduction. And using these factors, we define linear, superlinear, and sublinear convergence.